Well, thank you for joining us this evening, and I guess when I say that, I guess I should also say thank you for joining us and not going to see President Obama or the hockey game tonight, which is frankly, this is a much bigger event, of course, that's happening here in town. My name is David Staley. I'm an associate professor and director of the Goldberg Center, which is the Digital Public History Center of the Ohio State University History Department. And this is the Clio Society lecture series. Clio Society is a public lecture series that connects Department of History faculty to the wider community. We are very pleased this evening to host this lecture in the Columbus Museum of Art, as opposed to a location on Ohio State's campus, which we see as an effort to reach out even further into the community in which we serve. The Department of History takes the land grant mission of the university very seriously, and I hope you see the Clio Society lectures as proof of that commitment. If you visit clio.osu.edu, C-L-I-O, clio.osu.edu, you can see videos of our previous lectures. And my understanding is that we have an email sign-up sheet that we'll pass around at some stage, should you wish further notices about our public lectures. The Clio Society, Clio is the muse of memory, and the Clio Society was instigated by two of the alumni of our department, Stephen Millett and Craig Zimfer, both of whom have a passion for history that I know is shared by many in this room. Steve Millett has said of the Clio Society that if you loved history as an undergraduate, then you are going to love it now. I think that will be the case this evening. I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker for the night, John Brooke. John is Humanities Distinguished Professor of History and Director of the Center for Historical Research. He's the author of three books in early American history: The Heart of the Commonwealth, Society and Political Culture in Worcester County, Massachusetts, which won the Merrill Curdy Award for Intellectual History from the Organization of American Historians; The Refiner's Fire, The Making of Mormon Cosmology, which won the Bancroft Prize for American History, which is one of the highest awards that is presented to historians; and Columbia Rising, Civil Life on the Upper Hudson from the Revolution to the Age of Jackson, which was also award-winning. While he is best known as an historian of early American political and social history, a few years ago he developed a research interest in global environmental history, about which he's been teaching for many years. Indeed, his most recent book is Climate Change and the Course of Global History, A Rough Journey, which forms the basis of his lecture for us here this evening. Please join me in welcoming this evening John Brooke.
Well, thank you for coming. My gosh, you know, I heard all the events going on here around town today. I thought, we might have some crowd, but thank you all for coming. I'm going to talk about. Oops, let's get this thing going. This larger frame here. But I'm going to first kind of talk a little bit of news, a little bit of information about the world at large in which we live in this election year. I want to just kind of talk about, actually, one of the purposes really of an election like this is to talk to people about the climate situation. And so in preparation for that, I thought, well, why don't I see what people think and check out actually this very interesting Yale Project on Climate Change Communication. See what their latest numbers are, which are actually kind of interesting. 7 in 10 people around the country think that global warming is happening. You wouldn't know that if you actually watched the news and listened to the voices in our public sphere. But the reality is that a majority think it's happening. About half think that it is anthropogenic, it's human caused, which is way more than one would think if one was just kind of randomly looking at our peers. And in fact, they've looked at Columbus and they get the same results. So 70%, yes, global warming is happening for people in the greater Columbus area, the standard metropolitan region, I guess. And again, half-ish. 49% assume it is caused by human action. And another, another 25% think, okay, well, it must be caused by natural action. I'm going to try to move this group into this column, and some of these others, we'll see. I assume probably most of you are in this column anyway, but what's interesting, and it's not shown here, is that only 10% of the American public, again, one would not know this by listening to the public discourse, are complete deniers. It is a small minority. So there is some room for so we might call political optimism on the climate front. But I think basically that, you know, having looked at this stuff for many years, starting actually back in 88 when, I basically started getting interested in environmental history when I was about 15 years old. I've annoyed some senior climate historians when I said, you know, I started teaching climate history in 1968. And they're like, what are you talking about? I taught camp kids at Bird Sanctuary in Western Massachusetts. The details or the overview of what happened on that land over the previous 200 years, the natural environment that was there then. But what struck me is the impact of this. 2012 has really got to be the hinge moment. 2012, the droughts hitting the middle of the country. This incredible drought signature, there are some wonderful paleo maps of the mega droughts of the Middle Ages, and they look exactly the same, except they lasted for decades, not for a year or two. So this is 2011, this is 2012. The advancing drought of 2011-12 had a role. The impact of tornadoes and the relationship to the La Nina pattern that was driving the drought, two of which hit, one in Kentucky, one in Moscow, Ohio, down in the southwest corner. This was a slide I put together for a class out of the class I was teaching that spring. This had happened during spring break, and I popped this up as soon as spring break was over. It was there for us to kind of cogitate. This was a powerful wind system that came through and a storm system that came through. And obviously, that was March, this was October of 2012, and Hurricane Sandy, which, if you haven't been to New York, you don't really realize what an impact it had. There's still chunks of the subway system that are still down by the Battery. You cannot use them because they've been they're still flooded. Or if they're not still flooded, they're damaged from the effects of the flooding. This year, I was looking at this, putting in the final details of Hurricane Matthew and thinking, God, I can't even remember when the Blue Cut Fire was. Blue Cut Fire is a product of extremely dry conditions that happened early in the summer, massive flooding in Louisiana, I think we've already forgotten that it happened. Huge fires up in Alberta in the area of the tar sands development, but more importantly, in the area that's being infested by pine beetles, and which is definitely a climate change driven event. So 2016, this year we've seen so much, and no one's done quite the detail yet on whether Matthew was in fact driven by global warming or not, but clearly the pattern of increased velocity and intensity of hurricanes is a general expectation. Matthew's dissipated, and Nicole, the last time I saw Nicole was lurking as a little tropical depression off of Newfoundland. What it was doing up there, I'm not totally sure. Went through Bermuda and then calmed down a bit. Summer temperatures for the last, basically, we've just gotten through a pretty hot summer. Every summer for the last 5 or 6 years has been hotter than the one before. And in general, we have this arc of a pattern toward heat, if we just look at July's. And then obviously, there's this enormous series of crises that are really linked together. Yes, they are theological, ideological, but more importantly, there is an arc of crisis running from northern Africa up through Southwest Asia into the east, and it is in great part driven by drought conditions, reaching from Pakistan to the west all the way to to Syria. The Darfur crisis, which doesn't show up as a drought condition now, but the Darfur crisis of the last 20 years was driven by climate change patterns. And the, you know, the food crisis that set off the riots in Egypt was fundamentally driven by droughts elsewhere, the food-producing regions. In this case, China and as well as Australia were contributing to the conditions that lay behind the crisis in Egypt. Meanwhile, Syria is fundamentally driven by drought. Sunni farming communities destroyed by drought, not helped by Mr. Assad, flocking into these shanty towns around the cities, becoming fodder for rebellion in Syria. And if we look at the future, here we are looking at guesstimates of drought running back to the 50s. Here's the 50s. Here's roughly the present. Here we are in the future 50s. Here we are in the 2050s, and here we are in the 2090s. Drought is a condition that is going to be advancing. A whole host of things are beginning to sink into the body politic. The warming atmosphere and oceans, the velocity of storms, the issue of the actually, not a lot of people know about this, but the thermal expansion of the oceans, which is on top of the melting polar ice, is going to be contributing to rising sea levels. And on top of that, the acidification of oceans, and the latest thing, which I only heard about last week, which is the, oops, well, this is a general view of the projected patterns for temperatures, precipitation, the collapse of Arctic ice, and rising acidity. But this is the one that has suddenly popped up on the radar this September, which is basically ocean oxygen death. The gray areas are not affected, projected to be affected, but the various colors relate to times. And what we're talking about is really the warming affecting the oxygen production in the deep oceans, which produces 50-80% of the total oxygen supply. So if you push this far enough, you begin to worry. I mean, this is my first panic when I first heard this. We're not going to be able to breathe. Well, it's not going to happen tomorrow, but it's hypothetically business as usual. If we push forward and business as usual with the carbon consumption and global warming, we will literally be reducing the oxygen supply on inside the envelope of the Earth's system. So this is really, really particularly sobering. Particularly when you 50% is a big deal, 80% is a bigger deal. Obviously, it's not going to all happen simultaneously, but it is happening, and if it's not going to affect us personally gasping for air, it's certainly going to be affecting the supply of marine life in the oceans that feeds unbelievable numbers of people. So this is the basic story. As I put it to my students, I want to burn this into your retinas. You will see a curve that looks something like this 5 to 10 times tonight. What we're looking at here is the year-to-year estimates by NASA of temperature through time, and obviously the dramatic increases here in starting in the 1970s. And line behind it in green, the red line is a 5-year moving average. The green line is atmospheric CO2. I don't really joke about this. I was born here, 1953. CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere were 315 parts per million. We now are up here. We are at 400. And the rise since I was born, 1953, is greater than the entire rise since the beginning of anthropogenic pressures back around the 1850s. And significantly bigger. So it rose from 280 to 315, and then it's in my lifetime it has risen from 315 to 400 and 400 plus. So this is accelerating. We are in a world that the Earth has actually seen this before, but not in human time. And that's my point about deep history. So if we look at a model of what's happened over the past two centuries, this is the effect of global warming in the 19th century. This is the effect of global warming by the end of the 20th century. And I'll have something to say about these little blue patches where things have not warmed up quite so much over North America, Europe, and off of China. But you just keep that in mind. But we have this dramatic map now of the scale and intensity and acceleration of the pattern of global warming. Behind all this, obviously, are two basic realities. More people and more stuff. The green line again is the atmospheric CO2. The black line is CO2 emissions, and the red line is people. The people should be up just above 7.3 billion people. Keep in mind that in 1750 we were less than a billion. In 1925. We just hit 2 billion. So this acceleration that has happened in the last 50, 70 years is really, really stunning. So we are on this accelerating path. Not that it doesn't have interesting roots. Back at this kind of hinge point in the late 19th century, early 20th century. One of the ways of looking at this is that the Earth system has boundaries. The Earth has boundaries. The Earth has ecological space. We live inside an envelope. We live on a surface that sustains us. And we are violating those boundaries. This is the emblem of the Stockholm Resilience Project. And you may have seen this before. This is there, and it's based on quantification, which I'm not going to show you. Each of these lines is actually, they have the measurement that suggests a scale of damage. I'm only really going to be talking about this one. I'm only going to talk about climate change. But nitrogen cycle, the impact of it's an overwhelming amount of nitrogen going into the system, the biodiversity loss, the so-called sixth extinction that is underway now, the last one's being caused by massive geological forces, are actually per scale much bigger. But these three together transcend the green kind of bounds of safety within the Earth's system. Now, we started to talk about in the last 15 years, since I think 2002, maybe 14 years, is to talk about the Anthropocene, which is part of the title of my talk. What this means is the geologists, starting in 2002, I guess it was, began actively saying, wait a minute, we are no longer in the Holocene epoch. We're in something else. We're in an actual geological age that is defined by the imprint of humanity. So right now, there's a working group of an Anthropocene working group, AWG, which has been authorized by the Geostratigraphy Committee of the AGS, the Global Geological Society Organization, to define the point, the golden spike, which will answer this question. When did the Anthropocene begin? So this is a debate that I've thrown my two cents into. I'll show you a little stuff in there, mostly just to be an annoyance to where it's going to be. Because what I'm an historian of this period back here. I want us to be somewhat relevant, but the likelihood is they're going to decide on 1945. They're going to use the bomb as the major marker. It's a marker that will show up in the geological strata for forever. It's there. It's in the geological strata, and they will use that mark because it also has obviously political significance, and it just anticipates this massive, the last 75 years, massive expansion of human activity, human economic activity, human population growth, and general impact on the Earth system at large. So we don't know yet when it started, according to the geologists, but the understanding is that we live in a world that is different from what it was in the recent past, a world in which has been changed by our hands. We have become geological agents in the workings of the Earth system, in the workings of what I like to call deep planetary history. So what I want to do is just focus on one thing, and this could have been the title of the talk, which is CO2, the history of a number. And I want to look at CO2 over a long period of time, as long as we need to worry about it. I don't worry about cosmic history, but I do worry a little bit about the deep Earth history back to the beginnings, because it sets in context what we have done. We can't understand the implications of what has happened in the recent past, I mean the incredibly recent past, unless we think about this longer time frame in which we really become somewhat almost irrelevant, but striking out little markers in for human evolution, because we see how recently we have become what we are in this deep history of the Earth, and against this timeline of the history of CO2 and its oscillations around the point. So oscillations around the point. Here is one of the ways we know a lot about CO2. I downloaded these this afternoon. I always try to get the most recent. I can't believe they didn't give me yesterday. They gave me Tuesday. I'm quite annoyed. But on Tuesday, the reading was 401.49 parts per million. What we're looking at here is the Mauna Loa results from Professor Keeling set up with some considerable investment a research station on the top of Mauna Loa, and they began to measure CO2 in this beautiful, clean, pristine place. The pulse of the Earth. Each one of these is a summertime drawdown as the northern hemisphere draws down the CO2 from the atmosphere by plant growth, and every winter, a release. Drawdown, a release. And so we have this sawtooth oscillation marching up inexorably from 315-ish back here. Here's the most important date right here, 1953, which is still about 315. And here we are now, another important date. On Tuesday, it hit 401 on its way up in the process of a release from the summer. Another way to look at this is the two-year cycle. This is the way it's looking. I've been looking at these for a few years. I discovered these about 3 or 4 years ago. They're just stunning. The little detail. You get little daily hits there, and you get the monthly, daily, weekly, and monthly averages. So you can see them. You can see the pattern. And these weird outliers. Look at this huge spiral of CO2 readings last April. That just why that happened, I'm not sure. But what's been the great fuss recently has been that we are never going to go below 400, or it's going to take a lot of work. We've now gone above an average every year from now on. The last time we will ever get below 400 was in this fall of late summer of early fall of last year. And now here we are now. And late summer, and we didn't quite get below 400. So this is, in one sense, is no big deal. It's sort of where we were going, but it's a benchmark that we've gone over, and we no longer are flirting with that boundary. We've gone over, and actually, if we track this back a few years, about 3 or 4 years ago, there was a great drama when this. Late winter peak brushed up against 400. Now our summertime trough is above 400, and actually going higher. This is what it looks like over. This is the last week. I thought this would be fun. Here's the last week, so bouncing along, and it's interesting that it has a daily pattern too. That every night it seems to calm down. I guess these are daytime lows and nighttime highs. I'm guessing, I'm not sure. But that's, you know, that's the day of the readings. Here's the last 10,000 years. Early agriculture. Here's the last 800,000 years. Modern humans able to think about the world around them in a systematic way, plan, to talk, to tell stories. They might have developed the use of fire right about here, but in the midst of the Pleistocene, humanity evolved to basically what we are now, genetically really not very different. And it's only 300,000 years ago. And my point here is, we are up here at 400 points per million, at no time during the last 800,000 years did it ever get that high. This is the Ice Ages. These are the peaks of the interglacials. We should be in one of these interglacials. We should be sitting, and we were until not so long ago, sitting here about 150 years ago, sitting at roughly 280 parts per million in a normal place. We've gone snap into something else. So let us take that as a benchmark and move deeper into the past and go just kind of quickly without getting too lost in detail. Look into the deep past and ask a few things. First of all, why does it? The background question that you need to take away is, why does it matter when these readings of CO2 get so high? What are the big issues? And the huge question for the public should be, when was it ever this high before? And what were the environmental conditions when it was that high? These are critical questions, and actually the geologists have provided some very interesting answers. And the story of this number and all of its environmental implications is really a fascinating story. I want to just take a second, though, just to remind us a few little high school details. The greenhouse effect. We have to, when we're thinking about carbon, why is it important? We need to think about the way in which not only that we're producing greenhouse gases, the reason we're concerned about CO2 going up to 400 is that it is creating a blanket or adding to a blanket of greenhouse gases that are trapping heat, as does a greenhouse. That's the whole idea of a greenhouse. Heat comes in, but it can't get out. So heat comes in and it can't get out from the atmosphere. It's part of the carbon cycle. It's a natural part of the carbon cycle. The greenhouse gases are interacting and have been interacting since the beginning of Earth time with a carbon cycle operating through the whole Earth system. Some of it incredibly slowly. We are speeding up aspects of it, but it's interacting particularly rapidly with the oceans. But also volcanoes, and then obviously we are doing our addition. So the raw numbers, the basic reality here. Sunlight comes in. Some of it gets bounced back right away. It comes in. It is radiated back from the Earth. Some of that escapes. Some of that is the natural greenhouse. We need that. And I'll get to the reason why we need that. But what we're doing is adding a small amount. The natural greenhouse is 150 watts per meter. That's 150 watt bulb every square meter. We're adding a little 2.5 watt bulb every square meter to the entire Earth of enhanced greenhouse effect. So it doesn't sound like much, but it's we'll see that it makes a big difference. So let's just go super paleo for a few minutes here. Not too long, but we have to think about the context here. Why do we need a greenhouse? When was the last time? What did the greenhouses? Why is there a natural greenhouse? You have to keep in mind that our greenhouse now is thin and microscopic compared to what it once was. In the early Earth, the Earth was the oceans hadn't settled down, and the carbon dioxide hadn't settled down. Effectively, a huge amount of the Earth was outgassed, and over time, over broadly, during the Archean and the Proterozoic, essentially is reabsorbed into the earth and into an inert, either in the form of water and oceans, or into sediments, carbon, the carbon dioxide, much of it got reduced back into the sediments. What was its function? What was the function of this early intense greenhouse? Basically, back in the late 60s, NASA started asking questions about other planets. And James Lovelock began to look around and decided, our atmosphere is totally different from Mars. It's completely different from Venus, which have completely different greenhouse effects. And ours is highly made up of nitrogen and oxygen with a very tiny, really trace elements of CO2, whereas Venus and Mars have got huge amounts of CO2, producing on Venus essentially a runaway greenhouse, massive greenhouse effect that effectively produces a surface temperature of 460 degrees, and essentially where Venus's greenhouse essentially has it at 285 degree effect. Ours is a 31 degree effect, and leaving these are centigrades, 15 degrees at the surface. So ours is moderate compared to what Venus has, and it played a role. It moderated through time, but it played a role at the beginning because the sun was weak. Carl Sagan established this many, many years ago. I was an undergrad at Cornell, and I never went to his lectures. Never took his class. Stupid. But I feel kind of dumb about that. But I've begun to learn a little bit on what he did, which is. But his basic contribution was to make this basic argument that the huge amount of gases in the atmosphere mitigated what would have been an extremely weak sun. And over time, as the greenhouse thinned, the sun warmed up, and we had a rough balance. And the Earth maintained its warmth and maintained its some oscillation, maintained its began to develop the conditions for life to exist on Earth. In fact, life may have in fact drawn down some of that carbon. We'll go into those in detail. What I want to do is run forward from the deep past of the Earth to the last million years, last 600 million years to 600,000 years, is it 600 million years? Which is to say that we are out here. We are in what is called an ice house condition in the context of a billion years of Earth history. There have been incredible warm periods that we call greenhouses, that greenhouse conditions, greenhouse epochs, they're here in red. And in between them, there are these ice house conditions in which there are major glaciations. If we look in a little more detail, but this is where I really want to focus, because what they've been able to do is to give rough estimates. I mean, you've got lots of variability in there, there's a wide a range of probability of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, but the scale is pretty dramatic. Here we are, way out here, at about that sort of 200 to 300 range, and the Permian, one of the extremely cold periods of the last 300 million years, roughly the same. But this is the Paleozoic greenhouse with massive amounts, potentially as much as 6,000 parts per million. Now that's probably too high. It's probably 4,000, but still, this is this is 10 times what we have now. And a million years ago, 50 million years ago, we were up in the 2,000 to 1,400 range of parts per million. What did that mean? What was the difference between then and now? What we're talking about are, in the case of the greenhouse conditions, we're talking about dense rainforest conditions covering the entire land surface of the globe. versus the desert-like conditions of the Permian and with intense ice sheets if there wasn't desert. So what we're dealing with here is an oscillation between greenhouses with massive amounts of CO2 and also having continents that were spread apart with what's lying behind this is I think we're using a soccer ball in my classes, blowing up a soccer ball and suggesting that what we're talking about is the energy of the outer core is driving massive amounts of volcanic rifting, spreading the continents, and lifting the sea floors. So we have shallow, sluggish seas that have got equatorial seaways into which all sorts of organic sludge is deposited, versus the deep seas and north-south pattern of the, not east-west, not around the equator, but north-south, the water patterns, the ocean current patterns, driving cold conditions, cold temperatures from the poles toward the equator, cooling the Earth down dramatically. So we have these two different kinds of conditions, and one of which is completely alien to us. I mean, the world of these greenhouse conditions, of these dense, wet, high CO2. I'd like to debate with my students about whether we actually could survive in these conditions, whether the pressures in the atmosphere would support us, whether we could, in fact, zoom back to be with the dinosaurs 100 billion years ago, or we would just sort of explode or something from our lungs would break down from the pressures, the different atmospheric pressures. We should also keep in mind that a lot of fossil fuels came from that sludge that was deposited in the ocean, in the shallow seas, or in these forests that are laid down. So we have the Devonian Marcellus Shale, which is infamous in eastern Ohio as the product of what is now being fracked. Meanwhile, they're the coal deposits that are the product of the Devonian and the Carboniferous. And then we have the sluggish, shallow, warm, anoxic seas filled with sludge during the Mesozoic, which we now burn in our cars. Most of the gas that is burned, the petroleum is essentially established, built up under pressure from the deposits laid down during the Mesozoic. And we're talking about, just think of this, what this area is now. This is the greater Middle East, and that's where all the oil came from. It's sitting there from this Tethys Sea that ran sluggishly through the center of the Earth. Or the equatorial. So we have this warm, sluggish conditions with really high CO2. We, as mammals, and we as humans, are a product of this long-term cooling that unfolded over the course of the Cenozoic, the last 50 million years, that fundamentally, we're not looking at CO2, because nobody's really got any numbers for CO2 precisely at this level of detail. This is oxygen isotope 18 and its relationship to coming out of the sea floors, and they're able to fiddle with the chemistry and come up with a pretty darn good reliable estimate of temperatures and general environmental conditions. So here we are at the peak of the greenhouse, and then it's slow and decisive transition by around 35 million years ago, stabilizing and then dropping down toward us. Now, what is important about this is that 35 million years ago, the Antarctic started to glaciate. 2.5 million years ago, the Arctic began to glaciate. James Hansen, who is the now retired dean of NASA weather science and climate science, has been campaigning to point to this 35 million year ago mark, saying before that point, by his estimations, the Earth was higher than 325 parts per million, and there was no ice in Antarctica. So his point is, if we go above 325, which we've now done, obviously, and we had done when he started to be concerned about this, we are threatening to melt the Antarctic and also the Arctic, and clearly that's happening right now. So this benchmark of roughly, you could argue that really the last time we were at 400 parts per million would be about 40 million years ago. We haven't been there regularly as a planet. The planet has not been at that level for 40 million to 43, 44 billion years ago. It's in those conditions that there was no possibility for continental ice sheets to develop. So this is one of the reasons we need to think about this paleo story, because it sets our condition in some circumstance, in some picture of perspective. That little piece at the end, which is sort of visible here, here we have the last 5 million years. I've just put in the emergence of the genus Homo at about 2.5. And here's the Arctic glaciation kicking off at about 2.5 as well. These are measurements of oxygen isotope 18, which gives you a measure of temperature. We're descending down an increasingly cold circumstance, basically driven by changing structures where the continents are, that contributed to kind of the cooling down of the planet, getting it ready to respond to the orbital signals that the Earth is tilted to the sun. The Earth has an eccentric orbit. The Earth has those are the two I have here, recession and eccentricity. These things are happening all the time, but only after a certain point did they start to play a role, and basically through a lot of feedbacks, complicated stuff, contribute to, in this case, this is oxygen. This is CO2, rather. CO2 in the Antarctic ice. What we're looking at are the ice ages as measured by CO2 in the last 800,000 years. Basically driven by once the planet has cooled down enough, then the orbital signals start to play a role and we get these 100,000 year cycle of glaciations. Each one essentially peaking at about in the neighborhood of 260, 280 parts per million CO2, and troughing out in the bottom of the glacial periods at about 180 or so parts per million, about 100 parts per million range. So if we've gone from 280 to 400, we have increased from our baseline during the most of the last 10,000 years, more than the range of a deglaciation. So again, these deglaciations dramatically are very quick, they're pretty rapid. this one in particular, these last two are just zoop, straight up. This is about 1,000 years, just goes straight up. Well, we did it in about 100 years, we went straight up more than the scale. We have to keep that framework in mind, that there's been a pattern to this, routine pattern over hundreds of thousands to millions of years. We don't even worry about the deep paleo past, but the glacial past shows that there's been a very confined range. And here are modern humanity, at about roughly 200,000 years ago. I like to push back a bit. I personally think it will probably end up being about here, but right now we're about here for the emergence of modern humanity. One or two cycles, basically two cycles back in the glacial cycle, and we are now having been produced by this glacial cycle, now are changing it fundamentally. That was CO2 and the orbital patterns. This is CO2 and methane. Black methane, they have the same general pattern. Methane being produced in this case mostly by swamps and natural forces, natural natural landscape features that are producing methane, increasing methane when the CO2 rises, the methane rises with it. And then sea level. Sea level obviously goes up. When you melt all that ice, sea level rises dramatically. So it all fits together pretty nicely. And again, each the it fits together nicely. The methane, this is the CO2, the sea levels all having almost exactly the same patterns, which is what's really dramatic. So what about this is pre-human? And we want to then ask ourselves, well, when did we start to make an impact? When did we start to have an impact on CO2? And here's methane and CO2 over the last 20,000 years, coming out of the ice ages, a little jaggedness here, which is a big story, but I can't tell it right now. And then we have this pattern. It rises to a peak, it declines, and then it rises up again. Methane is in green, drops, ooh, and then it starts to go up again. What happened in here? Well, students in a class at UVA started asking these questions of William Rudiman, a climatologist at UVA, and he began to ask, what's the deal here? How did this happen? Why is it if the sunlight is rising and dropping, did the CO2 actually not go down too? Because the previous glaciations had dropped with change in the orbitally driven insulation, the sunlight, solar warmth. But there's this sort of strange thing happening there, starting thousands of years ago. It was methane. The same thing. So his solution is that actually early agriculture, not precisely early agriculture, but agriculture that was associated with the rise of the state 5,000 years ago, and particularly Chinese agriculture, Chinese rice paddy methane production. But generally, disturbance of the soil disturbances, land use can generate CO2 and put it up in the atmosphere. Certainly rice paddies produce methane. So he proposed, and it's still under debate, but he's proposed that effectively there was a pre-industrial greenhouse gas tortoise, slowly, small bits of greenhouse gases going up into the atmosphere versus this incredibly rapid industrial hare. Massive, short period of time, about half of the total that they put up previously went up in about 100 years. This people are continuing to work with this. This is Chinese population. This is Chinese Neolithic sites. And people are making the argument through a whole bunch of different ways that, in fact, there is the beginnings of anthropogenic effect. What it did actually, what Mr. Rudiman suggested did, is that it actually forestalled a glaciation. We're headed back down into a glacial pattern, and that was forestalled by agriculture. Very much under debate, but it is striking how unique this pattern of the Holocene that we've been living in has been. So what I've been playing with this in the recent past, and so maybe there's other non-industrial contributions to greenhouse effect. So what we're looking at here is the black line is U.S. industrial emissions. Zoom, shooting up from about 1860, 1870, zooming up. British industrial emissions, this green line, with not really, you know, we crossed that line about 1890. The blue line is U.S. land use emissions. And I should have actually started with the red dotted line, which is Chinese, a guesstimate of what the CO2 equivalent would be of Chinese methane. So that would, Chinese methane would have been the big contributor to a background greenhouse effect prior to what? Prior to the massive expansions and kind of clearing of North America became single most dominant greenhouse gas contributor in the late 19th century, over far surpassing British industrial emissions, far surpassing American industrial missions and crossing the American lines, crossing around 1902 perhaps, as the U.S. emissions from land use dropped, as the farms were stabilized. It was really the launching into destroying the original soil surface that puts up the worst of the CO2 emissions from land use. So land use played a role in this transition, but clearly, I mean, here's another model of a variety of measures, and they all here is industrial, global industrial and greenhouse emissions, and these are all different estimates of land use, all expanding during the Age of Empire. So hypothetically, we can think about the Age of Empire as an early phase of the Anthropocene. But clearly, the big one is the mineral fossil fuel Anthropocene. And clearly, this is the story that we're talking about, the antecedents, and then we're talking about the big story that drives these big effects, and is driving them right now. And it's, we're back to this basic reality that industrial emissions have this huge launching effect that's driven by population, driven by and drives the rise of atmospheric CO2. Now we can point some fingers. So here is, over the last 100 years plus, total carbon emissions for United States, China, India, and everybody else. So we're in the blue line, and every now and then we have been the largest single contributor to world greenhouse emissions. Here we are. This is World War II, obviously. It's there. Here we are there. We were, as a single country, certainly more significant than other countries, but what's dramatic here is this line does go up dramatically. I started teaching this class in 94, this class, my class, and I kept saying, look, China and India are about to decide, they're trying to modernize. And about 2002, it happened. The line, this red line is China, and it just bent and went practically straight up. And this is the history of the last decade that we know a lot about. We all have been watching, reading about the newspapers. The expansion of the Chinese economy has been one of a fundamental eruption of greenhouse emissions. So these are the totals, but this is the per capita. So we still, personally, you, have an enormous global carbon footprint. And we had our carbon footprint was particularly bad around 1973. Many of us remember 1973. I remember the price of hamburger doubling in about a week. The first year I was out of the dorms and on my own eating my own hamburger, and the price doubled during the 73 war. So we did in fact improve after these peaks. This long run up during the late 50s and the 60s toward our piggish consumption pattern as of around, what was that, 1973, and mitigated, moderated, a little bit of backsliding, and a certain moderation. But we're way higher, and you can see the bend in the Chinese story right there, but still, we are way, way higher than the global pattern, or China and India, just off the charts. We're not looking at Europe here, but Europe comes in about here. When we point the fingers at us, there's a reason for doing that. Now, there are some ironies and questions about what's been happening with global warming in the last 50 or 60 years, because when did we start talking about global warming? People started worrying about it here in the late 70s and the 1980s, when it seemed to start. There had, in fact, been a kind of a plateau. And actually, if you go back to the 1970s, some scientists worried about the onset of another ice age, which obviously did not happen. But there were, if we look at this now from the distance from 2016 back to 1880, we can see that, well, here's the natural pattern back here. There is a bit of a run-up. There's a bit of a run-up through here. Then there's a flat line from 1945-ish to about 1975, 73, 74, 75. Then a dramatic run up. Then there's something of a plateau in here. I probably should have moved that over to this point. This is actually going to keep that up. This is a volcano right here. This is about Pinatubo. That might be another volcanic action too. But clearly, it was something of a hiatus in global warming, which in the last 3 years has been broken, and we are surging up again. So why did this happen? What is the deal here? Does it have anything to do with this pattern? Here's the 19th century total mapping of total anthropogenic forcing from all kinds of greenhouse gases. This is the forcing, from the end of the 20th century. And there are these little umbrellas over the northern hemisphere. Over what? The largest industrial production zones in the world. Why would it not get warmer there? Meanwhile, it's warming in the tropics, it's warming in the Arctic, but over us, here we are in central Ohio, it's actually been kind of moderate. I never noticed the global warming, thank you very much. Well, that's because coal, fossil fuels, put up two things. They put up CO2, this is the dotted line. It also puts up sulfates, just like a volcano. So in 1992, I have this vague memory of beautiful sunny days and wondering, can I see the shimmer from Mount Pinatubo in Arlington, Mass? No, probably not, but I might have been faking that, but we're exaggerating. Mount Pinatubo put up sulfates that lasted for 2 years and reduced global temperatures dramatically. So this is effectively what we've been doing. We have been running industrial volcanoes, putting up two things. CO2 that distributes throughout the rapidly and permanently, effectively, lasts up there for decades and centuries. CO2 goes up into the stratosphere and does its thing as a greenhouse gas. Sulfates go up and they precipitate out. They need to be replaced. They precipitate out pretty quickly, but they reflect. So the volcanoes, big, huge volcano like in Mount Pinatubo, goes off once, has about a 2-year effect. But we've been putting up sulfates, or we were putting up sulfates, incredible, incredible volumes. So this is a map there's a diagram of the whole story from the 1880s down to now. What we're looking at here are sulfates and CO2. And what we're seeing is, here's the kind of initial run-up, and almost the perfect curve to the sulfates going up. And then, what's happening through here? I like to call this the first great interruption. World War I, the Depression, World War II. The sulfate line is jagged. Actually, the CO2 line is not exactly growing that much. And then they both grow dramatically together during the post-war boom, during the great economic expansions from 1950 to 1973. And then from 74 down to, it's maybe 2002, we see kind of a significant drop in sulfates. Anybody got a guess of why around 1989 the sulfates dropped off the charts? Any other thing happened in 1989?
Taking lead out of gas?
Soviet economy collapsed. So the taking the lead out of gas is this. Effectively, our efforts to mitigate did in fact create a sulfate plateau. The collapse of the Soviet Union, the Soviet economy, produced this drop right here. If you look at the details, country by country, you can see that. But so that's partly us having an impact and actually reducing the sulfate emissions and the collapse of the Soviet Union. Well, there's a certain irony in here, because this is CO2 emissions and sulfate emissions, but this is warming and sulfate emissions. Let's give it some pattern. And what we get is this. We get a interesting pattern where the red line follows this red line. sulfates are staggering. They're not expansive. They continued on this course. They kind of staggered along until they reached another surge. And during this period, sulfates not growing that much, was actually appeared in dramatic form. And then, during many of our childhoods and our young adulthoods, the temperature flattened out and the sulfates rocketed up and effectively created a mask over the potential for global warming. Doesn't mean there wasn't CO2 going up, but masked by the sulfates. Then we have the mitigation and the collapse of the Soviet Union, and we have global warming. So here's the irony that, and I've extended this because we have a little bit of data from another source, extended, it looks like sulfates are dropping now. Maybe sulfates dropping now are contributing to the re-expansion. Possible that we had a bump in sulfates contributing to this leveling off in global warming in the early parts of the last decade, and then in the last 6 years, sulfates dropping and warming jumping up. There are lots of other debate. There's a big debate about this, a big debate about what the oceans have been changing their amount of uptake, but I think that in the end, I think the sulfate pattern is going to play a role. So we have this irony that we have to kind of calibrate this. This is the Anthropocene. This is the irony of the Anthropocene, that we have started tinkering with the thermostat, the controls on the Earth system. We have got CO2 and sulfates going up. We're trying to balance them out. And when we balance out the sulfates, the CO2, which is sitting up there, starts to warm the Earth. So we have this problem. And we have this problem of how do we handle this, and where is this number going to go? Because there was a question in here whether things were leveling off, but in the last 4 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, it's been going straight up and at a dramatic rate. So what are we going to do? How is this going to be mitigated? Unable to connect to box. Why should I care whether it's strong to the box? Sure, you want to fix the box sink? Yes, I do. Okay, let's see. Go ahead. Okay, so let me just, I've taken too much of your time, but I want to just do one last thing. People talk lightly about, doubling, no big deal. Tripling, quadrupling, no, it's okay. We know, and first of all, where is that doubling going to come from? Some of it's going to come from us, but people have been worried for decades about a sudden triggering of the release of massive amounts of carbon in the global north. It's been sitting there frozen, and it's already beginning to be released. So the real panic about a sudden doubling or quadrupling is because we might not really put up that much more CO2 ourselves, but reach a tipping point where we release all this frozen carbon, and as well as methane. So what we get is, so what happens? Are we gonna double suddenly? Or are we going to quadruple suddenly? What does that mean? Doubling puts us up to a doubling from the current, which was a little lower. Doubling actually was the pre-industrial low, or doubling, which brought us up to about, is really 500, 550, which sounds, it's not so bad. It sounds pretty close to where we are now. Quadrupling puts us up at 1,200 parts per million. And actually, you guys know what that means now. Here we are, 1,200 parts per million gets us a long way back up the Cenozoic cooling pattern. We were looking at 400 at about 40 million years ago. 1,200 would put us back at least 100 million years ago, in completely uncharted waters. When mammals were little tiny shrew-like things scuttering about behind underneath the dinosaurs. It's completely an alien world. This is not really an option. We have established human civilization under our Holocene conditions. We can't depart too much from that. We're all held really pretty loose. So again, we have this scale problem. I want to close after a long oration here on a somewhat optimistic note. What are our options? Geoengineering? Well, maybe not. The problem with geoengineering is you've got to keep doing it. You've got to keep intervening. You've got to keep spending money to do something which you're not sure will have the effect you expect it to, but if it has an effect, you have to keep doing it, right? Because if you stop, you'll get a spike. Will some of those possibly might be scrubbers? Well, I kind of like the idea of scrubbers. We might put up CO2 scrubbers right now and reduce carbon that's already out there. Now, most people are, the recent surveys, are not very optimistic. It's unclear at this point whether we will do what's necessary. We could do something, but most people think we're not going to be able to pull it off. And then various other options, mostly either there's no problem anyway, or we really don't have any options. That's the popular opinion. Now, there is a holy grail that people have been starting to talk about they've been talking about this for years, but we've hit it for the last 2 years. And economists are debating it, but have we decoupled energy use from economic growth? And so people are pointing to the last 2 years, 14 and 15, as years of significant economic growth, not dramatic, but significant, without any global increase in emissions. So maybe we're starting to separate these things that have been tied together very dramatically. Maybe we are increasing the efficiency of economies. The way you decouple the economy from energy use is you increase efficiencies dramatically. And so people are, it's been happening for 100 years, or 50 or 60 years at least. The US has been increasing its efficiency for 100 years, since about 1916. Whether or not the increase in efficiency can happen soon enough. The US government, the Department of Energy, is touting in a series of publications this basic story, that things have suddenly gotten cheaper. That in this case, wind is fundamentally cheaper, and the amount of installed capacity has skyrocketed in the last decade. Solar PVC, photovoltaics, in this case, utility scale photovoltaics, and the cost has dropped dramatically, the amount of capacity has increased dramatically. The electric vehicles, the battery costs have dropped, they've kind of stabilized, like get those battery costs down further. The cumulative sales have gone from essentially nothing 7 or 8 years ago to pretty substantial now. Though I will admit, we do not have an electric car yet. There are actually some surprising political results in recent surveys. This is September. No surprise, Democrats feel that climate change is a problem the government should work on. What's striking here is that 84% of Democrats, no surprise, this is surprising, 43% of Republicans think that similarly, that the government should be involved in dealing with the climate problem. That is not what I expected. I expected to see this red line much higher, nicely symmetrical. And I suspect if we did this 10 years ago, we'd have a more symmetrical pattern, Republicans opposing. So again, this is about a month old, this polling data. Recently, there has been, now this was in the New York Times about a month ago, I guess, September 15th, based on a study done by the Epoch Institute of Chicago. They basically asked, how much would you be willing to pay for a month on your electrical bill to mitigate to mitigate carbon impacts? 57% said at least $1, and it went up from there. 20% said $50. So the director of this institute said, "Look, he did some as he could call back of the envelope math. came up with $15 per household by 12 is $180 per household. In 2009, last time we addressed climate change with a Democratic House and Senate and President, could that happen again? The Congressional Budget Office put the number for not just electric, but the entire impact on U.S. households at an average of $175. So U.S. households, by this guess, are willing to pay $180 a month. $180 annually. They estimate $175 annually. They give you some details if you like them. How much of the impact would be distributed on different quintiles of the population. So it's what's striking about this is there may well be the political will out there. We are the big emitters. We are per capita the big emitters, and we do need to provide leadership. What's striking is that when the leadership happens, things do have impact. This is CFCs from 1960 to 2020, and the impacts of the boycotts. What would have happened if there had been no boycotts that started? If you remember the right guard, don't use spray can deodorants. Back in the mid-70s, if that hadn't happened and the Montreal protocols had not happened, the scale of CFC emissions would be off the charts. So that already mitigated things, created a new high or a new lower projection from where the impact of the Montreal protocols weighed in, and this is the decline. The decline going out to the future. Now, today's newspaper, the New York Times, had an article about India and air conditioners, and the problem is the post-CFC air conditioners are considerably more expensive. The poor in India would like to have air conditioning. People can sleep through the night, they can think clearly, and it's getting more expensive. So this is part of the problem. But basically, I like to think of this, the whole analysis I like to use is that we've gone through a series of what are called Schumpeterian cycles, of dramatically expanding technological revolutions, innovation revolutions, and we're essentially on the verge of what's called the sixth wave. Is it a fourth industrial revolution? But some kind of dramatic transition. And really, the political battles are really between paleo industries, petrochemicals, and the neo industries that are underway. So let me just end by suggesting this, that we more than hope, I do think that people do need to act. So there's been a sort of a political message here that we need to think about the future. And the future actually is in our grasp, if we're going to act. So let me stop there. I'm sorry I ran on for quite so long. So what's our procedure? Shall we see if people have any questions?
Let's have questions, yes.
Listen.
You didn't mention the population control, population reduction at all.
Well, the funny thing is that since the age of Erwin and Erwin in 1968, population has, the dramatic story there is population has the fears of them were 20 billion. Now we're talking stabilizing at 10. What's dramatic is places like Iran and Mexico in the last 15 years have gotten their birth rates dramatically down. So the last remaining frontiers of the democratic revolution are the Islamic world and sub-Saharan Africa. And the basic problem is this. It takes energy to modernize the economy. And it takes a modernizing economy to drop the birth rate. They go together, but they require energy. Energy produces stuff. So we're caught in this paradox. That's the fundamental equation that you have to work out, which is how do you there's a dynamic between economic growth and the rise of essentially a security for a population allows them to reduce their numbers, their fertility rates. And part of that increasing economy is employment for women, which is dependent on literacy. As soon as you educate women, there's a tight correlation between the literacy, education of women, and the drop in fertility. Oh, yeah. The first place this happened was in the United States, right after the American Revolution. So yeah, population is important, but I've stopped talking about it quite as much as I used to, because if you don't parent, that's not quite, it's actually, we're on the cusp of getting through the problem. We're gonna end up with this massively expanded population, 2 billion to 8 billion, and a population that's gonna get progressively older, which I sometimes think is not such a great thing. A younger population, more energetic population, but the population's problem is not what it was the way when Paul Aaron wrote his book back in the day.
It seems like there's a race going on here. This peak line, the CO2 emissions and global warming, and the things that we're doing to try to mitigate that.
Right.
So looking into the future, there comes a point where all that we do here may not have the impact we need in order to stop the devastation that you're suggesting.
This is the problem. Clearly, the big problem is this. The CO2 goes up, and it takes the very slow workings of the carbon cycle and pull it back down. It's even if we could stop all emissions now, we go into magic land for energy. It would take 150 years to bring the 400 down toward 300. Because of the cleaning. That's why I like the idea of the scrubbers. This, the reality is whether the little technocratic fixes, the little technological fixes, can move fast enough to bend the curve. But this is what the IPCC, International Panel on Climate Change, are constantly modeling different scenarios for different mitigations. If we mitigate at this rate, we will return to normal within 100 years. If we don't mitigate, you have to start someplace. And reality is that the question is how much can we get to put into the rate. These numbers, these $180 a year numbers, are really quite dramatic. I've heard a story of somebody asking a physicist in Berkeley, what would it take? And he would say, take 30 years and a couple trillion dollars, we'd solve this. Not a big deal. Just make it happen. I mean, that's the reality. Make it happen. So I know a certain candidate is downtown right now, or at OSU. I won't mention that person's name. My problem is not just with him, but with his recent colleagues, because he's had colleagues in his party. The whole party has been standing in the way of dealing with this problem. So I'm not supposed to get up. I'm not at the university, so this is reality. Despite the fact that we have 43% of rank-and-file Republicans who think that the government should act on climate change, we have this entrenched reaction, paid for by petrochemicals, paid for by the coal industry, of politicians standing in the way of change that should have started much more rapidly 15 years ago. But your basic concern, can we do it fast enough? We cannot do it fast. We are going to have some level of impact. No question about it. The question is, we can't avoid it. The question is, can we slow it down?
I just wanted to bring up a point that the science of climate change is actually quite old. It's been around since 1896. Dante Arrhenius wrote a paper about directly linking CO2 to Earth warming. 1896, 120 years ago. It's been around a long time. Calorimetry experiments we've done in the 20s and 30s where you can just look at energy inputs on a benchtop and different CO2 concentration. we've known about it for a long, long time. It's just disseminating information has been ineffective.
And disseminating information, but also measuring. I mean, it was desktop. It was back in the envelope calculations. This could be a problem. Sure. But then there was the problem of measuring the atmosphere. That is more I learned about that actually. That the U.S. government started measuring the atmosphere. We're worried about what they were doing with bombs, and that started accelerating. And so literally, at this point, I mean, there. What's striking about the literature is this. There are some important early articles from the early 90s that I cite just because they should be cited. But there's so much in it. The scale of work on climate history and climate science that did accelerate in the last 15 years, it's just phenomenal. So, and this knowledge about how the system works.
I was around the university in Bert Fuller, early mid-80s, late 80s. Grad school in the 90s. And I remember the discussion of climate change, in the 80s, sort of there was some back and forth about things, but pretty much everybody was convinced. Every researcher that would come through,
sure.
On Earth, through Paul Bach or whatever. And I've probably been to 500 or 600 talks in my lifetime, professional meetings, and I've never once ever heard a scientist mention that they have anthropologic or anthropomorphic global climate change is not occurring.
Right.
Never once.
Not once.
So
yeah, this is
these are geophysics meetings, geology meetings.
So it does come down to a political problem, which is that the public does not believe the science. And there's
there's disinformation.
Disinformation, massive disinformation. The same people who have been running the pro-tobacco disinformation, literally, is a group of 10 people who were kind of instrumental in a whole host of regions, a whole host of areas that have slowed down. And a little bit what I made for my business.
Point of information, you said sulfates go up and CO2 goes up with industrialization. Then you said we've controlled the sulfates rather fairly well. Define the sulfates for me.
Well, it's sulfur dioxide that goes up as a byproduct of combustion. And whether that be combustion of automobiles or whether it be combustion of coal burning furnace, coal burning carburetors. So sulfates go up, the sulfur dioxide goes up, turns into sulfates, but they precipitate out. They, in a matter of weeks and months, a molecule will precipitate out and be gone. But it's got to be constantly replaced, which is, again, the point why volcanoes, they produce a cooling effect that lasts for a discrete amount of time. But the constant pressure of sulfates going up creates an offset, which is particularly dramatic around the northern hemisphere, right over the heavy industrial areas. It doesn't quite go up as far as it stays a little closer to the surface. It reflects back. It changes the global heat calculation, and contributes to this to a stalling of warming. The CO2 is still going up, but totally independent. And the CO2 goes up higher, and it persists for decades and centuries.
Yes. The sulfates cause acid rain, sulfur dioxide.
Right.
Back in the 90s.
Well, back in the 70s, The whole, Ohio was putting up sulfur dioxide was killing the forests.
Acid rain. That was a common term.
And acid rain, that was what the reason they got the sulfur dioxide under control, and mitigated to some degree the acid rain issues. Yeah.
I found that slide showed that sort of the two, continuing with the sulfates and the sulfides, and the two bubbles that were measured in industrial areas. So I would assume that those are on a continual downtrend from, you hear terms like clean coal and cleaner power.
Yeah, I mean, these creating these things is not easy. And I tried to find other ones, and these guys put together a beautiful map, Simon Tech et al. I haven't seen a trying to update it, trying to get the kind of sequencing that you're suggesting. Can we see this? Can we see this dissipating through time?
Yeah.
This is their model of the total effect over the entire century. It may well be that people have tried to kind of turn this into a time-lapse photograph and give us a little video of its intensification and waning. But we would expect this, if we could have such a thing, we should expect to see that waning. Certainly.
So that means that the irony is that in these areas, we're going to be catching up.
Yeah,
aggressively.
Right. So yeah, so the future, there's a whole literature on the effects of warming in North America, for example. What's going to happen in Ohio? What's going to happen in North America? You kind of captured that and saw that in the drought picture. Drought, North America, they projected drought dramatically for the projected down to 2050, 2090. And here's the problem. So the reality is you reduce the sulfates, you solve one problem, and you enhance the background problem.
So the debate I've always heard is between if there is in fact one day going to be a carbon tax on a global level, is it going to be the historical perspective, and so you're going to charge the historical emitters more, or is it going to be the current perspective, and you're going to charge the developing countries more?
Gigantic, gigantic political debate. This is the UN conferences have not always succeeded. I mean, really, literally, not succeeded because the developed world, meaning the United States and Europe, but mostly the United States versus China and India. China and India want to be able to continue to emit, to reach us, to build up their economies to point X, and ask the United States to back off, and this has been the problem. Since the days of Bill Clinton, the Congress has not been willing to do this because there's too much economic pressure. This is the essential problem. Should the historic emitters who have actually begun to reduce their emissions, of course, why do we have lower emissions? Why does Europe have dramatically lower emissions? Because they shipped all their industrial production to China. So we've offshored, we've globalized the industrial work, the industrial energy use. We've dumped it out to China. We are responsible for their emissions. One way or another, it's a global problem. That position eventually will prevail. The question is, will that eventuality come too late? But it's a political problem.
So I'll give myself the privilege of asking a final question. So this is obviously an area that has drawn the attention of geophysicists and scientists and term historian, so what is it, you provided a lot of information, like what do you think an historian brings to this discussion and debate that maybe scientists and others don't?
A good question. I think it's, I mean, a willingness to engage directly. I mean, what you have to do is to do an analysis, which I began to hint at. I have an analysis of economic and political history that has to be interwoven with, and that's something the scientists kind of try to think about, but they, on the outer edges, but it's not their it's not their mandate. But it's not, and they might do it as sort of an overreach, but they feel uncomfortable doing it. I feel comfortable as a historian synthesizing, and so I've been able to get some control over the scientific material and weave that onto my command of economic history and political history. So, I mean, the book got to be, the book is actually pretty cheap. $0.50 a page, it's $33 paperback, 600 some odd pages, you get the whole thing, nothing's missing. It goes from soup to nuts. But I was itching to do questions of state formation while I was, it was just lurking under the surface. And in fact, if you read between the lines, you can see an analysis of the state in the second half of the book.
I was not really reading between the lines. I just didn't push it as far as I could. I might have, but the book would have been 1,000 pages. Another way of going. In the end, as we were just saying, this is a political problem. The politics of the state, the emergence of the modern state, is ultimately going to be the solution. The modern state and the modern economy co-evolved, and now they have to co-solve the problem.
Well, I ask that question very deliberately because one of the things we try to emphasize in the Clio Society talks is that oftentimes in times of national crises, you'll see the stories on the TV, right? Tell us what this means, right? After 9/11, there are all sorts of concerns on TV. And my sense has always been that historians can help us make sense of lots of things, not just simply the catastrophic events, but historians can tell us an awful lot, make sense, even an important issue like climate change. This is something we try to do, try to bring up in all of our Clio Society lectures. As I said at the beginning, we have an email sign-up sheet. If you're interested in notifications about future lectures, happy to introduce you to those. We still have the room for a few more minutes if we want to engage with John, but just to thank John Brooke. And thank you all.